Dear friends, in the earlier modules, we have discussed different types of waveguides and the propagation of electromagnetic waves through the waveguides. We also discussed how the energy can be stored with the help of microwave cavities. We also seen how the measurements can be done by defining various types of physical quantities. As a sort of introduction, we also seen how the waveguide can be converted into a system which can store the energy. However, at microwave frequencies, how to model the system, that is a very important aspect in microwave communication and waveguides. Many a times we need to divert the energy, partition the energy, store the energy, use it for various applications, and for such things we have to use what we call as waveguide components. So, in this module, let us see what are the different types of waveguide components and how to model them in terms of S parameters. After completing this module, you will be able to know different types of waveguide components and understand the working principle of waveguide tees and rings. In addition, you will be able to understand the use of waveguide corners, bends and twists, and you will be able to understand the S metric representation of waveguide components. We are familiar with the terms coaxial cable and waveguides. Coaxial lines are used to interconnect various components such as slotted lines and sections, loads, impedance changing devices, attenuators, etc. Coaxial cavities and wave meters can be found to be described in literature with adequate details to account for the theoretical, instrumental and technical aspects. Similarly, we can have different types of waveguide components. A partial list of waveguide components is as shown. In general, microwave components associated with coaxial lines and waveguides are used for several applications, some of which can be listed as shown: unidirectional transmission of power, termination of electromagnetic wave, control the direction of wave, etc. are some of the applications. To start with, let us discuss about some components dealing with only a single waveguide. Really speaking, to understand the necessary operations involved in any of the applications listed earlier, one needs the knowledge and proper understanding of the ways of coupling energy into and out of sections of waveguide or cavity. We know that electromagnetic wave energy can launch electromagnetic waves from waveguide to free space or vice versa. In the case of waveguides closed at both the ends, coupling into and out of the waveguide can be achieved either by inserting probe or loop into the waveguide or by using holes or slots in the slides of the waveguide. Electric field coupling using probes and magnetic field coupling using loops are the two commonly used methods. The center wire of a coaxial cable extended into the waveguide can serve the purpose of a probe used for electric field coupling. In one of the earlier modules on waveguides, we have studied such methods of excitation of different modes in the waveguide. The end of the coaxial line bent in the form of a loop when inserted into the waveguide serves the purpose of magnetic field coupling. We know that the characteristic impedance Z0 of a coaxial cable plays an important role in devices based on impedance matching techniques. It is given by the expression which is as shown. Sometimes it is needed and possible to modify the characteristic impedance by varying the values of L and C to tune the waveguide for elimination of standing waves, if any, due to load mismatch. The requirement of changing L and C can be fulfilled either using eyries or screws or posts in the waveguide. Thin flat metal strips inserts of low conductivity with thickness much smaller than a wavelength are known as eyries. These are located in the cross section of the inner sides of the waveguide walls. Their positions in the waveguide determine whether they are contributing a series inductance or parallel capacitance. Inductance eyries in the case of a rectangular waveguide is as shown. Capacitive eyries for the rectangular waveguide is as shown. Note an interesting arrangement of plates working as a resonance eyries in the rectangular waveguide. Have a look at a resonance eyries in the case of a circular waveguide. It looks very simple and interesting. Instead of eyries, we may use an adjustable screw or post in the center of the top of the waveguide. Location of the screw or post must be carefully chosen so as to have desired inductance or capacitance. The length of the screw or post is an important parameter in this case. The length smaller than lambda by 4 corresponds to capacitance, while the one greater than lambda by 4 contributes as inductance. Use of a series screws with a separation between 3 lambda by 8 to lambda by 2 provides a tuning which is equivalent to that in double stub matching used in transmission lines. Friends, all these things look very interesting, but can you think about the mathematics behind the designing aspects of such different types of eyries, posts and other waveguide components? The mathematical aspects are highly complicated and must be studied separately with sufficient patience. Don't be much afraid. We are not going to enter the jungle of mathematics behind the designing and working of such waveguide components. We can understand that if the load does not match with the waveguide impedance, there is a possibility of reflection loss. We can have waveguide termination components and sections to avoid such mismatch loss and power loss. Tapered or movable pyramids can be used for this purpose. Tapered or stepped resistance cards are also used for the same purpose. The discussion done so far gives some information about the components involving a single waveguide. Now, let us turn to the discussion of a little more complicated topic related with waveguides, namely microwave circuits and devices. We know that an assembly of microwave devices connected to each other so as to achieve the transmission of microwave signal in the desired way may be called as a microwave circuit. The term hybrid microwave circuit indicates the possibility of presence of microwave devices of different types in the circuit assembly. Let us discuss about some important devices wherein waveguides have more than two openings. Obviously, such systems or devices can be thought as if several waveguides are connected together. In general, the simplest of such assemblies is known as a T-junction. Three types, namely E-plane T, H-plane T and hybrid T-junction Ts are of direct concern to us. Hybrid T-junction is also called as a magic T-junction due to its special action. Let us try to know in brief about some important points related with such microwave T-junctions. In some applications, it is needed to split the electromagnetic waves in one waveguide and divert them into the other two waveguides. For this, we have three waveguides connected to each other, giving rise to a single device with three waveguide inputs. In other words, it is a 3-port waveguide connection. Can you compare it with a T network comprising of 3 impedances as shown? The only difference lies in the replacement of impedances by waveguides. Instead of a coupling of 3 different waveguides, one may think that a third arm is connected to the main waveguide to obtain a T junction. Where and how to connect the third arm? Two ways are possible for such connection. Accordingly, we have 2 types of T's, namely E plane T and H plane T. In the case of a rectangular waveguide of dimensions A into B, that is A by B, we know that generally one dimension, say A, is greater than the other dimension B. Here A is called as width, while B is called as height of the waveguide. If the third arm is connected across the longer dimension A of the guide, the T we obtain is called as an E plane T as shown. On the other hand, if the third arm is connected across the smaller dimension B of the waveguide, the T we obtain is called as an H plane T as shown. One may have a description of E and H T in some different manner also. Let us number the 3 arms of the junction as arm 1, arm 2 and arm 3 as shown. It is very interesting to see how the electric field gets split and appears into arm 2 and arm 3 of the main waveguide when fed through arm 1 of the E plane T junction. Let us consider a TE wave with dominant mode TE10 entering through the arm 1, which travels further towards arm 2 and arm 3. The electric lines of force are represented by solid lines in the diagram. At the end of the conducting walls of the arm, the electric field lines originating and finally terminating on the waveguide walls are as shown. On the other hand, magnetic field in the H plane T is as shown. In the module on field and circuit theory, we have seen that the quantities voltage and current in circuit theory are related to the quantities electric field and magnetic field in the field theory by the relation as shown. Thus, in principle, the device can be described either in terms of voltage and current or using the quantities electric field and magnetic field. However, at microwave frequencies, the circuit quantities, namely voltage and current, bear no significance. Instead, we have to deal with the electric field and magnetic fields. Measurement of power is a better choice at microwave and RF frequencies. Measurement of incident, reflected and transmitted waves at various ports can lead to the estimation of many physical quantities associated with the microwave system. Association of various physical quantities with the waves to be measured at the input and output ports is as shown. Nowadays, use of S parameters is done on a large scale in microwave circuit analysis due to simplicity in its measurement using vector network analyzer. The term vector implies the measurement of amplitude and phase of the quantity. Network analyzer can cover a large range of frequencies ranging from 50 megahertz to 40 gigahertz or so, with adequate frequency resolution of about 1 hertz. The measurement results can be displayed on a Smith chart or gain versus frequency graph. When microwave systems or microwave device is to be modeled in terms of mathematical quantities, then we have to search for some method. Especially when the microwave system or a device is described as a 2-port network or 3-port network, etc., then we know that it can be described or analyzed with the help of what we call as parameters, H parameters, AB parameters, Y parameters, Z parameters, etc. These are quite familiar to us from undergraduate studies. However, when we consider microwave applications, then at microwave frequencies, such parameters are of no use, because they use the conditions at short circuit and open circuit at the output terminals of the device or of the network, and we have to measure the voltages and currents. The concept of measurement of voltage and currents does not stand at microwave frequency. So, we have to deal with, or we have to just use what we call as scattering parameters, which are abbreviated as S parameters. So, let us see something about S parameters. In the earlier module, we have seen the way in which a two port network can be described in terms of S parameters. The related equations, which can be written in matrix form, are as shown. Have a look at the terminology, defining equations, the conditions, and the significance of the S parameters of the two port network. In general, every linear microwave circuit or device, when represented as an equivalent N port network, can be represented by what is known as S matrix of order N, containing N square element in it. For example, a microwave T having three independent ports is characterized by S matrix of third order, that is a 3 by 3 matrix consisting of 9 elements in it. A general 3 by 3 matrix S is as shown. It be noted that the elements Sij in S matrix are in general complex numbers and represent ratios of reflected and incident powers at the various ports under specified conditions of the remaining ports. Generally, in Sij, the first suffix I corresponds to output port number, while the second suffix j corresponds to the input port number. Loosely speaking, a port can be defined as any place where we can deliver voltage and current or an electromagnetic wave. Arm, on the other hand, is a continuous geometrical unit. However, one should be careful about the numbering of the ports or arms while obtaining S matrix representation of the microwave T's or any other hybrid component. The S matrix obeys the general rules of matrix algebra. The operations like transpose, inverse of S matrix, etc., are frequently used to infer about the nature of the microwave network represented by the S matrix. One should know some important terms and definitions related with S matrix. For example, if S is equal to S dash, that is, if the transpose of matrix S equals the matrix S, then the corresponding network is a reciprocal network. This implies the fact that S matrix of a reciprocal network is symmetric about its diagonal. Here is an example of a S matrix representing a reciprocal network. The S parameters in general are complex numbers. For a system not having any active device in it and satisfying reciprocity condition, S parameters are equal to their corresponding transposes. From the S matrix, we can determine whether the corresponding network is lossless or not. S matrix of a lossless network is unitary. In other words, if the inverse of transpose of a given S matrix equals the complex conjugate of the S matrix, then the corresponding network is lossless in nature. This property can be put in other words by saying that for a lossless network, the dot product of any column of S matrix with the conjugate of the same column equals 1, while that with the complex conjugate of any other column equals 0. Here is an example of a S matrix representing a lossless network. the related computations are as shown. Given an electrical circuit or system, we can obtain its S matrix. Conversely, given S matrix, we can predict the corresponding possible circuit. As an example, consider the S matrix of a circuit as shown. The S matrix corresponds to the network as shown. What will be the S matrix of the network shown here? Mathematical analysis gives the S matrix as shown. How to obtain it? Definitely, one must know the mathematical tools and techniques for obtaining such a matrix. The knowledge about some important results and theorems related with S matrix can be highly useful for quick analysis of a given microwave circuit. For example, from the equivalent circuit of a 3-port network, we can derive 3 theorems of a 3-port junction. These theorems are useful in obtaining the S matrix of a 3-port junction, with the help of which one can describe the characteristics of the junction. The statements of these theorems are as shown. Statement number 1. A short circuit can always be placed in one of the arms of a 3-port network in such a way that no power can be transferred through the other 2 arms. Statement number 2 says, if the junction is symmetric about one of its arms, a short circuit can always be placed in that arm so that no reflections occur in power transmission between the other 2 arms. This implies matching of impedances of the 2 arms. Lastly, that is in statement number 3, we understand that for a general 3-port junction of arbitrary symmetry, it is just impossible to have matched impedances at all these 3 arms. As a consequence of these theorems, one should note that there are no reflections from the perfectly matched junction, resulting in 0 values of corresponding S parameters in S matrix. It is very interesting to go through the mathematical proof of this statement based on the principle of contradiction. These theorems stated above can be used to obtain S matrix of microwave devices and components. The simplest example of a microwave component or device is known as a T. The structure resembles the English letter T. Let us discuss in brief the S matrix representation of hybrid T junctions. As shown in the diagram, let us consider an E plane T in which the axis of its side arm is parallel to the E field of the main waveguide. Let us assume the collinear arms of the T to be symmetric about the side arm. For such a symmetric T, we have 2 different transmission characteristics depending upon the port for the input in the E plane T under consideration as shown. When the microwaves are fed into the side arm, that is port 3, the waves appearing at port 1 and port 2 have same magnitude but are out of phase. Hence, we have S13 is equal to minus S23. Here, negative sign implies or simply means that S13 and S23 have opposite signs. Note that in SIJ, the first suffix I corresponds to the output port number, while the second suffix J corresponds to the input port number. In general, in the case of an E plane T poorly matched at the T junction, S11 and S22 are non-zero. If the collinear arm of the T is symmetric about the side arm, the S matrix is given by the expression as shown. We can have H plane T, also known as shunt T, as shown. Note that in this type of T, the axis of the side arm is shunting the E field or parallel to the H field of the main guide. If the input is fed into port 3, the wave will equally split into port 1 and port 2, which are in phase and of equal magnitude. Assuming symmetry of collinear arm about the side arm, the S matrix is as shown. E plane and H plane T have their own advantages and applications. The combination of the two, known as magic T, and is also known as hybrid T, and it has many interesting features. It has two collinear arms, one E arm and one H arm, thus totaling four arms and hence four ports. S matrix for a magic T is as shown. This S matrix can be obtained by noting many characteristics of the T. We have to note the magnitudes and phases of the input and output waves for different combinations of the ports of the magic T. Some of the characteristics are as shown. Two waves of equal magnitude but in the same phase, when fed into port 1 and 2 of the collinear arms, will result in 0 output at port 3 of the E arm, while the output at 4 of the H arm will be additive. Secondly, the wave when fed into the H arm, that is port 4, will split equally between ports 1 and 2 of the collinear arms, but will not appear at port 3 of the E arm. It be noted that the permittivity for wave traveling allowed by E or H junction are in accordance with the boundary conditions on E and H fields. The wave fed into the E arm will produce an output at ports 1 and 2 of equal magnitudes but in opposite phases. Surprisingly, the output at 4 of the H arm is 0. When described in terms of S parameters, it simply means that S43 is equal to S34 is equal to 0. The wave fed into one of the collinear arms at port 1 or 2 will not appear in the other collinear port at port 2 or 1. This is due to the fact that E arm causes a phase delay while H arm causes advancement of phase. This means that S12 is equal to S21 is equal to 0. One should remember that wave entering in the E arm cannot exist out of H arm and vice versa. Two waves input at the two parts of collinear arm will exit from E arm only if they are in phase with each other, and will exit from H arm only if they are out of phase with each other. How interesting are these results, isn't it? Magic T is used for applications like impedance matching measurements, mixing, duplexing, etc. As an example, two transmitters identical in all respects, if connected at the port 3 and port 4 of the magic T as shown, will give 0 output at port 1. The output at port 2, however, will be twice the input. This fact can be used in radar applications, wherein it is needed to apply power to the antenna, which is double the input power obtained from each of the transmitters, avoiding loading effect. Obviously, antenna is to be connected to port 2. Magic T can be used to fulfill the requirement of feeding two waves in phase or out of phase into the same waveguide. As against this, it can be used for splitting a wave into two waves either in phase or out of phase. When one of the two collinear arms is terminated by a matching load, magic T provide only one arm for some applications as shown. An extension of the principles used in hybrid T's gives rise to a new hybrid component known as hybrid ring. Here in hybrid ring, four arms are connected by means of series or parallel junctions to an annular ring of proper electrical length at proper intervals as shown. Hybrid rings, also called as rat race circuits, are used to sustain standing waves. The wave fed into port 1 will not emerge out from port 3. Similarly, the wave fed into port 2 will not emerge out from port 4. This is due to the phase difference resulting in cancellation of waves travelling in clockwise and anticlockwise directions through the annular line. Ideally, phase cancellation can take place only at a specified frequency for the given hybrid circuit. The S matrix for an ideal hybrid ring is as shown. In practical hybrid rings, there is always some small leakage coupling. Hence, the diagonal elements of the S matrix are not exactly zero. Sometimes, it is needed to change the direction of the guide through an arbitrary angle. For this requirement, components like waveguide corner, bend and twist are used. Note that over some distance, the wave propagation will be continuous and along a straight line path through such components. We can define a mean length L between the continuities. There can be a partial reflection of waves at the geometrical discontinuities in these components. Proper selection of value of L can minimize such reflections from the discontinuities. In corners and continuous twists, L is selected using the formula as shown, wherein n is a positive integer and lambda g is the wavelength in the waveguide. The waveguide bend can be thought of being a section of a hollow circular shell of width a and thickness b. We know that an arc of a circle can be treated as a part of n-sided regular polygon inscribed in a circle with large n. Thus, accordingly, the wave propagating through a bend can be supposed to be suffering reflections from several such discontinuities. A formula given by Southworth is highly useful to minimize such reflections. It gives the minimum radius of curvature r for a given small reflection as shown. One must appreciate the brain work behind the derivations of such formulae. Well, friends, we have to discuss some special types of waveguide components like directional couplers, circulators and isolators. However, due to time limitations, let us discuss about them in the next module. As a summary, we can remember that microwave circuits or microwave devices can be represented mathematically using the S parameters. S parameters are highly useful at microwave frequencies for analysis of the device with respect to measurement of various physical quantities associated with it. Microwave T's or hybrid T's, they are the combinations of E plane and H plane waveguide components and can be represented using S matrix in a different way. S parameters are highly useful for the analysis of such systems. Bends, corners and twists are also useful for directing the microwave energy in the desired direction.